Written by Arlo Guthrie about his Thanksgiving arrest for littering in the Berkshires, the song was released in 1967 and quickly became a holiday staple on the level of stuffing and cranberry, even spawned a feature-length movie by the same name. Guthrie is on tour celebrating the 50th anniversary of Alice's Restaurant, and he sat down with us on a recent stop in Lowell. Now 72, his curls have turned white. But he has the same sarcastic smirk that he wore when this song came out.
This song's called Alice's Restaurant. It's about Alice and the restaurant. But Alice's Restaurant is not the name of the restaurant, that's just the name of the song.
Is it fun for you to play this in front of people, or is it your stairway to heaven?
Well, unlike a lot of other people, I decided a long time ago that I was not going to do this every night of my life. Especially, you know, if it's one thing if it's a 3-minute song. It's another thing if it's almost a half an hour.
You can get anything you want at Alice's Restaurant.
It doesn't become like you could sleep through it or think about what's for dinner in the middle of the song.
Even though you're kind of thinking about what's for dinner on Thanksgiving.
Well, that's other people. We don't actually listen to the song on Thanksgiving.
It all started two Thanksgivings ago. It was on 2 years ago on Thanksgiving when my friend and I went up to visit Alice at the restaurant. But Alice doesn't live in the restaurant. She lives in the church nearby.
Do you remember the fateful Thanksgiving meal that spawned the song? Do you remember what you guys ate and what you did?
I mean, Alice is still a dear friend of mine. You know, she lives on the Cape. And one of the things was she really was a great cook. She also had a number of restaurants, and all because of the availability of the song and her proximity to it. She was never a major character in my tale, but you know, people that hear that stuff go looking, and so people came to Stockbridge and said, well, "Where's the restaurant?" You know. And we would say, "That's long gone." "Well, where was it?" You know. And they'll stand there and take selfies or something out front.
The back room, right?
It was called the back room. It was right off the main drag in Stockbridge, which only has one main drag. And so it wasn't hard to find. Eventually, she got out of that whole thing altogether and moved to Provincetown, where she's been ever since.
At the bottom of the cliff was another pile of garbage, and we decided that one big pile's better than two little piles, and rather than bring that one up, we decided to throw ours down. That's what we did. Drove back to the church.
You changed her life in a lot of ways, and I guess she changed yours.
Well, it was difficult for her, and I was sympathetic. The real problem that we had as individual people was that when they made the movie, they based it on the song, right? And the song is based on these real events. And it takes about 20 minutes to tell. But a movie has to be an hour and a half. So how do you make a movie that's an hour and a half when you only have a 20-minute story? Well, you end up making up a bunch of stuff. And so they had to make up an hour and a half of stuff in order to create a movie. People see things on film and assume it's true. And it became sort of an iconic film of the time, even though it really wasn't a great film.
So we got in the red VW microbus with the shovels and rakes and implements of destruction, headed on.
But it sounds like you remember that kid who wrote that song and told that story and why all these years later.
No one could have expected, no one would have anticipated that a story like that would ever become popular. I mean, if I thought it was going to become popular, it would have made it a hell of a lot shorter to begin with. You know, if I knew I was going to have to repeat it for 50 freaking years.
When we got to the police officer station, there was a third possibility that we hadn't even counted upon, and we was both immediately arrested, handcuffed. And I said, "Obie, I don't think I can pick up the garbage with these handcuffs on." Shut up, kid.
So are you inspired at this point or depressed by the fact that the message of that song is maybe more relevant now than it was 50 years ago?
I think, you know, the human condition doesn't change all that much. Irony is still funny. Being anti-authoritarian is still valid. Being suspicious of people who get elected is still a good idea. I don't care what side of the aisle you're on. I don't care what your story is. I don't care if you agree with me or not. But there are certain fundamental things about being a human being that are healthy. And one is a suspicion of people in authority. One is a sense of humor, I think, is a requirement. When people get angry, they lose their sense of humor. And I think a sense of humor is necessary to survive as a human species, not as an artist, not as a comedian, but we need to laugh, and we need to laugh at ourselves. And if we're able to do that, we'll get through any of these storms we have to weather these days.
And I said, Obie, I can understand you want my wallet, so I don't have any money to spend in the cell, but what do you want my belt for? And it said, kid, we don't want any hangings. Said, Obie, did you think I was going to hang myself for littering? Obie said he was making sure.
Marlo Guthrie may not be listening to this tomorrow, but he has his own Thanksgiving tradition, a special meal for those in need, at the Old Trinity Church in Great Barrington, Mass., the same one featured in the story, which Guthrie later purchased and turned into a cultural community center. This is WGBH Radio.
Thanksgiving 2018 is the title of our episode on the 22nd of November. From BRN Radio and on the Boston Red Network. We came in here with a special interview with Arlo Guthrie, if you recall Arlo Guthrie and his classic song Alice's Restaurant about Thanksgiving and its service to humanity. It was presented by WGBH, the PBS station in Boston. We are setting the tone for Thanksgiving, for actually what the American Thanksgiving is about. It is not about just eating turkey. It is a family day, no doubt about that. And on any family day, one should look to where the humanity is. Not just one's family in particular are looking forward to the sales that will come. Many of them will come on the evening of Thanksgiving Day. We'll air about 6:30 Eastern Time, so some of the stores will be open and they will have their Black Fridays, Cyber Mondays, etc. out there. The Chicago writer Emma Young has called for a boycott of Black Friday, an interesting situation. We'll have more on a Friday at Jabba. A little bit of a lineup this weekend. We do have Friday Jobber. That's on Friday morning. Traditionally, it's always there. And on a Saturday morning, the week that was, Monday, the Monday morning quarterback. That is all from the Boston Red / political side of WBRN Radio. Get those call letters mixed up here. And also we have a special programming on a Sunday. It would have been the 78th birthday of Jerry Pippen, our former broadcast partner. We'll have that special, and we'll get that mass up today where we'll have it. Hopefully we can do some call-in over at the Blog Talk franchise. We'll give some instructions to people, as we all obviously are older than we were in 2015, and some of his people that were familiar with, or I should say some of the people that were familiar with his broadcast career. But today we look at Thanksgiving and the lives of working people across the U.S. We have a number of stories coming up. We have a story that Mary posted in Montana about Montana workers. And also one we found in the New York Times about Amazon, the behemoth, and the Somali workers that work there in the upper Midwest. Let's firstly go to Montana. And the item here, this is from the paper of there, the Helena paper in Montana, help wanted in Helena, low unemployment rates leave employers struggling to find workers. This is a first in a three-part series about worker shortage in Helena and in Montana. Signs are virtually everywhere, now hiring, help wanted, apply inside, etc. Montana and Helena specifically have a shortage of workers for a few years. More businesses from retail to professional workers are posting these types of signs. The Montana economy has grown since the depression of the late 2000s. Since then, the state has seen steady wage growth, while unemployment rate has dropped on a fairly consistent basis over the past several years. This leads to a situation today. This is not a crisis. It's not unexpected, according to the Montana Department of Labor and Industry. Chris Bradley, an economist with the department, says economists saw this coming a long time ago. He explained that Montana has more people entering retirement than the job market, an older population there. Economists take it on that it's demographic issues. A lot of baby boomers are retiring. A lot of people are finding there are fewer job seekers. The rate of unemployment in Montana is 3.7. is the same as the nationwide unemployment rate. The Department of Labor expects it to go below 3% before 2025. That would be roughly, 7 years? By comparison, the unemployment rate is 2.7 in Idaho and 2.8 in North Dakota. Now, those are neighboring states. Bradley said Montana's low unemployment rate results from the strength of its economic growth compared with the diversity of the job market, which helps the state weather the depression better than other states. Lewis and Clark County has the lowest unemployment rate than the state, with 2.9% job seekers unemployed. Bradley says this figure isn't adjusted seasonally. The trend of low unemployment and fewer job seekers is a statewide issue. Economists do see higher unemployment in rural areas. Now, this is something we find all the time in the rural areas, out of the cities. You'll see higher unemployment on the reservations of Native or Aboriginal peoples there, period. Only 1.2% have been unemployed for more than 15 weeks or longer seeking work, according to Bradley. He said recently unemployed workers, people between the jobs and people choosing the next job, more carefully make up much of the unemployed figure. The trend of more workers out than in is expected to continue for the next 10 years. And this is one of the themes that we have talking to younger workers at university, that when the books begin to be cleared of the present situation and other economic downturns are caused by the policies of DJ Trump, they will find, and these are people that are around 18 to 20 years old, roughly that age group, the same as the Montana experience, jobs will open up. The state expects around 100,000 workers, only one-fifth of the total workforce to be retired in the next one-fifth in the next 10 years. This coincides with the end of the baby boomer generation exiting the workforce. Bradley says economists expect the labor market rotation to even out around the state. At this point, businesses will learn to adjust to small labor markets. And that has been one of the themes we've been hitting upon on a Numbers Man. That is our macroeconomic program from WBRN and on the Boston Red Network. They cite some fellow that owns two McDonald's restaurants. Says McDonald's Corporation has all studied the demographics of its customer base and workforce for some time. McDonald's is predicting the same trend. for every five people that are retiring, we only have two younger people aging up to replace them. The birth rate is the lowest it's been for years, and families used to have five or six kids, now have only one or two. They can't afford them. The aging population paired with higher economic growth has created a high demand for workers. However, the demand has also created a tight labor market that has resulted in a higher wage growth for Montana families. The average continues to trend up when adjusted for inflation, real wage growth. But now this is something here, is only 1.1%. In the past 6 months, the Helena Job Service has posted more than 2,600 jobs from 580 employers. Of the 2,500, those postings were duplicates of previous posting. And this is one of the things you learn into, run into. About 2,400 people use the job service. I've been personal online during this six-month period, and around 760 received one-on-one staff assistance services in the office. However, this doesn't necessarily indicate the number of people who might use the computer job search, just the ones who required one-on-one help. The majority of these job seekers, around 52%, were women. Individuals under 25 make up the smallest age group, with 12% seeking job. Now they didn't talk about people 55 and older there, and we don't have a statistic here. Let's move on quickly because our production time, to the Somali workforce in Minnesota's Amazon facility. Labor organizers and researchers say they have not heard of Amazon's previously coming to the table after workers' pressure, for, even for private discussions. This is by Karen Weiss of the New York Times. It was on the 20th of November. This is an immigrant named Mohammed. He came to Minneapolis from Kenya. Kobik is the name of the young lady. She had been living as a refugee in 2016, got a job at a new Amazon warehouse near the city. At first, she enjoyed packing the boxes for delivery to customers. But over time, she said Amazon required her and her co-workers to pack it at a faster rate, at least 230 items an hour, up from 116. Now, this is quite common in many of the Amazon facilities, and these speed ups, Amazon being a non-union shop. Amazon said, she said that Amazon let her take paid breaks to do her prayers as required by state law, but her managers told her that she still needs to keep the pace. There is a pressure. She is 24. Ms. Mohammed is 24. She says people don't far worry one day that they will one day that they will be fired. She says scores of East African colleagues, many of them like her, born in Somalia, respond in unusual ways for Amazon workers. They organize to complain. Now, tied together by close cultural connections and empowered by a tight labor market, they appear to be the first known group in the U.S. to get Amazon's management to negotiate. After moderate protests over the summer, the workers have had two private meetings with the management of Amazon. Labor organized researchers say they were not aware of Amazon coming to the table previously in the United States amidst pressure from workers, even for private discussions. Last week, Amazon offered some compromises at its facility in the Minneapolis area. The company said it would require a general manager and a Somali-speaking manager to agree on any firings related to productivity rates, designate a manager to respond to individual complaints within 5 days, and meet with the workers quarterly. By Saturday night, a group of about 40 workers had decided that the compromises were insufficient, with a primary concern being of the pace at which they are expected to work. They voted to stage a large protest and walkout that will be on December the 14th in the thick of the holiday season. Each community is a little different, and each one we work to ensure our employees have a great experience. That's from Amazon. Ashley Robinson was a spokesman there, added that the company did not see its work with the East African workers as a negotiation, but rather a form of community engagement. Spinning it. Its outreach efforts with veterans, gay rights, bisexuals, transgender workers. To the workers, a former meeting was a result of more than a year of organizing by the AWU Center. It's a non-profit helping East African workers. Nobody assumes a Muslim worker with limited language skills in the middle of Minnesota could be a leader in a viable fight against one of the biggest employers in the world and bring them to the table. That is from Mr. Muse. He's executive director of AWU. That is AWOOD. Amazon has sought to squeeze more profits out of its operation as growth slows. That is from Brian Alinsky, the company's financial chief, told investors in October. Getting better efficiencies from operations was a corporate priority. Now, we've had cases in New England that literally Amazon workers had been wheeled out of those facilities. I believe it was in New Hampshire, was it in Connecticut, by ambulance, literally, to pass out the heat. The company now has more than 110 so-called fulfillment centers across the country, other outposts that handle logistics. This is a mini city, another Amazon company spokeswoman described them with unique cultural and demographics. They opened this particular facility, the size of 20 football fields, in suburban Shakopee. That's in 2016. It needs more than 1,000 workers to operate it, and the local unemployment rate is around 3.5%. That left the company with limited labor pool to hire from. Immigrants make up a growing share of the Minnesota workforce. Somali refugees began settling in the area in the 90s, fleeing the country's growing violence and a civil war. More than 46,000 Somali-born residents, their children are in the state. 4 out of 5 live at or near the poverty line. The recruitment effort with East African immigrants, hundreds signed up through the Confederation of Somali Communities, that's a nonprofit. For a while, Amazon ran buses to Shakopee from the main neighborhood there, the Cedar Riverside, known as Little Mogadishu. And the company had spaces at local warehouses dedicated to Islamic prayers. 60% of the 3,000 workers in the region are 3,000 workers in the region are East African, is what AWU estimates. But the group has found only one manager to speak Somali. Mr. Ibrahim said that in Somalia, this is a lady, Safa Ibrahim, she worked for the American and United Nations aid groups before fleeing to a refugee camp in Ethiopia and was hired. This would be one of the older workers there at the Amazon sorting facility. I work hard. I got employed the month. The first time she really loved the job, she said, and remains impressed by the business built by Jeff Beals. Hope I'm pronouncing his name right. I pronounce it several different ways. But after Ms. Ibrahim returned from a breast cancer treatment, a new manager scoring her for working slow, she said she felt the manager did not see her as a woman who had worked for aid groups overseas and overcome the breast cancer, raise a daughter who got into medical school just 5 years after arriving in the U.S. Those are accomplishments there. The new manager is like military. They don't give you respect. That's typical in these warehouse settings. I remember as a student many, many years ago, well, 40 years ago, that in a warehouse, don't remember the name of the company, it probably doesn't exist anymore, that they had some military type running the production line. Not unusual. Let's see, shared space with, with the Minnesota Chapter Council on American-Islamic Relations at a Lutheran church. Has political allies in Omar. Omar is a newly elected congressperson from Minnesota. She's attended events there. Somali immigrant himself, Muses, is M-U-S-E, worked for the union organizing home health care workers. That is a big push many places. They have a WhatsApp text message group and have held several small actions to build awareness of their organizing. So this is one when the Amazon annual Prime Day shipping event coincided with Ramadan. They held a protest seeking higher workload, a lighter workload, during the fast. That is sort of like the for Muslims, the Christmas holiday. One thing to know about the community, we talk a lot on the phone and chat over coffee and not beer. And that makes organizing easier, no doubt about it, because this is such a... there's such a density in the workforce at this stage in the game. Amazon has a very difficult time replacing many of the workers, particularly at the peak seasons. That is from a researcher at the University of Chicago that focuses on warehouses, Bev Galinas. Anyway, that is a couple of stories we are covering here, and let me just... move along a little bit here to speed up our focus. The headline at the Washington Post here with honey instead of vinegar. Speaker Pelosi moves forward. DJ Trump has been making all kinds of noises today. He's taken on the very conservative Chief Justice Roberts of Indiana. Roberts said that there's no such thing as an Obama judge, a Bush judge, a Ford judge, etc. And old DJ is mad because the Ninth Circuit, out of San Francisco, blocked one of his pet little projects there. So he's ranting and raving about it. The House Judiciary subpoenaed Kumi and Lynch. Lynch used to be the Attorney General. And let me see. South Korean megachurch pastor sentenced to 15 years for ordering, for raping a woman in God's order. Well, I guess it's about the same situation there. Some roundup on this quote-unquote family day here. The prosecutors in the Los Angeles DA's office declined to prosecute Michael Avente. He was accused of domestic violence. That can be a felony, or if it's referred to the city attorney, it would, quote-unquote, be a misdemeanor. That will go on. And as we move around here a little bit, we'll go now. Brasic, that is an agreement. Let's get back to DJ Trump. This is from the BBC. He threatens to close the whole Mexican border, which would impact more the commerce between Mexico and the U.S. than a few thousand immigrants that are trying to make it to the border. It would have a devastating impact on cities like Tijuana and other border crossing cities. There are many, many of those between Mexico and the U.S. So stay tuned on that particular one. DJ Trump had a telephone conversation from his luxurious hotel there in Palm Beach. First president to do something of that and actually own the hotel. So for him, with his, I don't know what it is, 15, 20 course meal or whatever's going on there, and he usually goes to a Coast Guard barrack to talk to Coast Guarders, one of the little traditions of DJ Trump. Let me just move around here a little bit as we get to ESPN. There'll be a number of games later in the day, and we'll report on those on Friday Jobber. Some college football games, which we report on. In general, we don't report on the NFL because of the conditions of Colin Kaepernick there. And we'll look at the NFL in terms of other things. We did post something on Facebook on the running back, Mr. Adrian Peterson, primarily on new running backs moving from being just running backs to other positions in football. One of the things that is started, these traditional games, generally speaking, involve the Cowboys of Dallas and longstanding and other teams. Used to be the Lions, used to be mixed into this. Anyway, and the Bears, well, yeah, the Bears-Lions game here is a traditional Turkey Day event. John Madden reported on it for many, many years. I'm just looking at some of the scores that are coming in here. Colorado and Air Force 20-13. It's in the fourth quarter. And Ole Miss will be tonight, from what I can see, there. Now, let me just kind of move on here a little bit. Well, we're in pretty good shape here as far as time. And we'll just end the broadcast there. We started out with Arlo Guffrey talking about the meaning of Thanksgiving. And we came in here and we'll go out with Walter Cronkite. And the assassination of John F. Kennedy that occurred 55 years ago in Dallas, Texas. This is a Boston Red from the Jerry Pippin broadcast booth live. Happy Thanksgiving to everyone out there, and also a happy holiday, because in a diverse nation like the U.S., there are people that celebrate these days. There are people that do not. But what we wanted to point out here is what Arlo Guffrey was talking about, not necessarily a religious holiday. It is a secular holiday. It is the largest holiday for travel in the U.S. There. And the commercialization that starts after, much more, more so than Christmas. Christmas, again, being a family day, we assume, but not as much of a family day. It has been commercialized. And on numbers, man, we'll be talking about the numbers there. The numbers are not as good as they were in 2017.
Dallas, along with Governor Connolly of Texas, they've been taken to Parkland Hospital there, where their condition is as yet unknown. We have not been told their condition at Dallas. In the downtown hotel room, a group had been gathered to hear President Kennedy when he was waiting his arrival. Let's switch down there now, where Eddie Barker of KRLD is on the air.
As you can imagine, there are many stories that are coming in now as to the actual condition of the president. One is that he is dead. This cannot be confirmed. Another is that Governor Connolly is in the operating room. This we have not confirmed. The president was whisked from the scene of the attempted assassination, or assassination depending upon his condition, of course, at this hour, by bus to Parkland Hospital. And the president undoubtedly is in the emergency room at that hospital, which would be on the first floor of Parkland. No word is yet. We are awaiting something more official. It is, of course, difficult, certainly, to go on scanty reports.
This is Walter Cronkite back at the CBS newsroom in New York. We have just been advised from Dallas that blood transfusions are being given to President Kennedy. Let us recall for you now what has transpired in this.
KRLD is reporting they've been told by somebody in the hospital the president is dead. Only a rumor, but they've been told that KRLD is saying.
Well, that's a repeat of something that you heard reported to you directly a moment ago from KRLD television in Dallas, and that is the rumor that has reached them at the hotel that the president is dead. Totally unconfirmed, apparently, as yet. However, let's go back to KRLD in Dallas.
Operating room, we do not know what his condition is, but the report is that the president is dead. This is not confirmed. This is something that word just came to us a minute ago. The word we have is that President Kennedy is dead. This we do not know for a fact. The word we have is that he is dead, that he was shot by an assassin at the intersection of Elm and Houston Streets just as he was going into the underpass. The word we have is from a doctor on the staff of Parkland Hospital, who says that it is true. He was in tears when he told me just a moment ago. This is still not officially confirmed, but as I say, the source would normally be a good one.
That was Zeddy Barker at our affiliate KRLD in Dallas, Texas, speaking from the room where President Kennedy had been scheduled to make an address to three Dallas organizations. But an assassin's bullets cut him down on the way to that meeting from the airport. It was just an hour ago that the incident took place. We have just learned, however, that Father Huber, one of the two priests called into the room, has administered the last sacrament of the church to President Kennedy. Regarding the probable assassin, the sheriff's officers have taken a young man into custody at the scene. A man 25 years old, we just have a report from our correspondent, Dan, rather in Dallas, that he has confirmed that President Kennedy is dead. There is still no official confirmation of this, however. It's a report from our correspondent, Dan, rather, in Dallas, Texas. We're now going into that Dallas luncheon the president had planned to address. Let's go back. Prayers, we understand, are underway.
That we may reveal that calm that shall be pleasing to thee.
Vice President Lyndon Johnson has not been seen in the corridors of the Parkland Hospital. He was said to perhaps have been slightly wounded in the arm. Mrs. Lyndon Johnson says that the vice president, though, is fine. Throughout the streets of Dallas, the Dallas police had been augmented by some 400 policemen called in on their day off because there were some fears and concerns in Dallas that there might be demonstrations, at least, that could embarrass the president, because it was only on October the 24th that our ambassador to the United Nations, Adlai Stevenson, was assaulted in Dallas, leaving a dinner meeting there. From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago. Vice President Lyndon Johnson has left the hospital in Dallas, but we do not know to where he has proceeded. Presumably, he will be taking the oath of office shortly and become the 36th President of the United States.